Hey guys, it's Max. Today we're going to be taking a look at the video editing performance of the brand new 2019 5K iMac with i9 8-core 16-thread processor and Vega 48 graphics. I'll be comparing the performance in Final Cut, Premiere Pro, and DaVinci Resolve with a bunch of different codecs to my 2017 5K iMac that's completely spec'd out, which has been our workhorse since it came out, and we've been very happy with it. And we've been waiting for this update for a very long time. I'll just give you guys the quick answer. I am very impressed. As always, there's affiliate links in the video description to configurations that I would recommend for different use cases, as well as to RAM kits, where you can save up to $680 if you install 64 gigs of RAM yourself instead of buying it from Apple. I'll also leave a link to my step-by-step install guide showing you exactly how to do it in just a few minutes, and no, it does not void your warranty, and you can still get AppleCare and all of that good stuff. On top of that, if you want to, you can actually get 128 gigabytes of RAM in this iMac, which you couldn't do before unless you bought one of the Pro models, iMac Pro or a Mac Pro. These kind of performance tests and comparison videos take so long to do. I was in the office for almost 16 hours yesterday, got less than 6 hours sleep, came in today to do more testing, getting all this data ready for you guys. So if you guys appreciate all the hard work, time, and money that goes into it, please use those links. That really helps us out. Now, there's another question that a lot of you guys had that I had myself. Will this i9 MacBook with 8 cores, they jumped from 4 cores all the way up to 8 cores, is it gonna overheat? I was very shocked and surprised by the results. I'll leave a link to the video where we tested that out. That's on our tech channel. Let's jump into the performance. I'm gonna start out with Geekbench 4, but I do wanna say that I'll also be comparing this iMac to the iMac Pro. After seeing some of these results, man, I have to do it. So if you guys wanna see that comparison, make sure you guys are subscribed and you guys have those notifications enabled. So starting off in single core, we have a score of 6406. That's 15% faster. And just looking at that single core score, that is extremely high. This CPU is rated up to 5 gigahertz, and I haven't reached exactly 5, but very close to it. But if we look at the multi-core, we have a score of about 71% higher. Now, of course, Geekbench 4 is an all-around benchmark testing a bunch of different tasks. So when we jump into Cinebench R15, that's a rendering benchmark, here we have a score that's over 80% faster. And that really is gonna give you some extra push if you're gonna be able to max out all those cores. One question that I've been asked a lot is it worth spending the extra money on the Vega 48 graphics? Let's jump into Geekbench 4's graphics test. We get 20% higher score for OpenCL and 25% higher for Metal. Personally, I was expecting a bigger difference here. Of course, this isn't exactly conclusive to video editing. We're gonna see those numbers in a bit, but stick around to the end of the video because I will be giving my configuration suggestions based on what kind of codecs you work with and what video editing program you work with as well. Let's jump into video editing. I'm gonna start off with stabilizing a 20-second 4K clip. Here in Final Cut, we get 25% faster results. Both are extremely fast. Looking at DaVinci Resolve, here we get 30% faster. Here in Premiere Pro, you see kind of a bigger difference time-wise because it takes so much longer. Now let's take a look at a 5-minute 4K project. This is H.264 footage from a Sony a7S II with 2 LUTs and film grain applied. And in Final Cut, we only see a 5% faster render time. In DaVinci Resolve, only 7% faster. But in Premiere Pro, we get a result that's 40% faster. Now, why do we get almost no difference in the first two programs and a bigger difference in Premiere Pro? Well, in Final Cut and DaVinci Resolve, we're not actually limited by the systems at all. We're held back by the QuickSync chip, which in the past was actually like the fastest thing and made a huge difference. Now, all the other components are so fast that Intel needs to update their QuickSync technology to work even faster. And that's really, really weird to say. Both these systems are barely touched when you're playing with this footage. Smooth like butter, no issues, no drop frames. I mean, the system is idling when you're playing it back, no problems at all. Now, before I jump into editing 8-bit H.265 footage, 10-bit footage, before we look at different raw codecs, I want to give a big shout out to our sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with more than 25,000 classes in videography, photography, business, and more. It's available on both Android and iPhone with the ability to download any course for offline viewing. So stop wasting your time playing Candy Crush and expand your skills with Skillshare. I'm currently checking out color grading for filmmaking, the vision, art, and science. They also have a ton of filmmaking, drone, and video editing classes. Skillshare is hooking it up and giving away a free 2-month unlimited access trial to the first 500 people who click the link in the description box. And after that, it's only about 10 bucks a month. I highly recommend joining their 7 million members, get access to 25,000 classes, and stepping up your game in 2019. Now we're taking a look at a 5-minute 8-bit H.265 project, exporting also to H.265. And here in Final Cut, we have a score of about 20% faster. In DaVinci Resolve, we have 11% faster. And in Premiere Pro, we have about 300% fast. That just means it's 3 times as fast. That's a huge, huge difference. Now let's take a look at 10-bit H.265 or HEVC. This footage is from the Fujifilm X-T3. I think a lot of cameras are gonna start shooting with this, but those older computers like my 2017 really struggle with it because they don't have good hardware decoding, whereas this new system has it built in. In Final Cut, the new iMac is 75% faster. In DaVinci Resolve, 45% faster. In Premiere Pro, just 4% faster. So Premiere Pro didn't see much of a difference compared to the 8-bit, which had 300% faster, 3 times as fast. So in the actual timeline in Final Cut, it edits super well, and DaVinci Resolve as well. Premiere Pro, it has a harder time in the timeline, but when you go to export, it's actually much faster. If you look at the actual scores, it seems like it's using, some kind of hardware encoding, where the previous iMac would sometimes drop frames and get a little bit glitchy. It's maxing out the graphics card because it's trying to read that the codec properly. It does struggle, where with this new system, because we have a new graphics card, and especially because we have a new Intel processor that has good hardware decoding, you get like 2% CPU usage when you're playing back this footage, and the graphics card is like at a third instead of being maxed out. So if you're working with H.265 files, man, there is a massive difference, and I would absolutely upgrade. I'll just tell you guys right now, if you're working with 8-bit or 10-bit, definitely go for the upgrade. And in Premiere Pro, I mean, it was pretty much unusable before, it was terrible, where now it's actually working quite well. One thing I have to point out is that my 2017 iMac, when I'm editing it, the fans are at full blast when I'm exporting it. It's like a fan, a hair dryer, something like that, where this thing is silent. You can't hear it at all. The fans are idling. Definitely go watch the overheating video after this one. That part of it is really cool. For some of you guys, it doesn't matter. For a lot of you guys, that matters a lot. So take note of that. Now let's take a look at Canon Cinema RAW Light from the C200. This is also color graded with a LUT applied. This is 4K 60 footage, just so you guys know ahead of time. And here in Final Cut for a 5-minute render, it's 35% faster. In DaVinci Resolve, 50% faster. And in Premiere Pro, 90% faster. A big, big difference. Premiere Pro really likes having a nice high core fast CPU, like you guys may have noticed, and that is a massive difference. Now we also get a difference in the actual timeline performance. So if you're in Final Cut, the previous iMac ran at about 43 frames per second, meaning if you're working with 4K 60, you're dropping frames, it's choppy. If you're working with 24 or 30, you could be good as long as you're not doing too much with the grade or effects wise. In Resolve, we went from 44 FPS to 60 FPS. So as you see, this new system, just like the iMac Pro, can handle 4K 60 RAW graded. I will say that graphics is close to being maxed out if you're working with this graded 4K 60 Cinema RAW footage, but the iMac Pro actually functions in the same way. It's almost maxed out, at least the base iMac Pro. So that's just a little sneak peek to the iMac Pro video that I'm gonna put out. But I'm happy you get an iMac that's a lot less expensive than iMac Pro that can edit 4K 60 RAW with some color corrections and a LUT, where the previous one, it would be choppy. So that's a big difference. Now in Premiere Pro, the actual editing experience at full resolution isn't good, but there is a big improvement. We went from 7 FPS playback on the 2017 to 18 frames per second playback. Keep in mind that's full resolution. So if you do drop down your playback to half, you should be able to edit, 24, 30 FPS in Premiere Pro, whereas the previous iMac would not. You'd have to drop to a quarter, and it really doesn't look that good at that point. Now that playback could be improved in the future if Premiere Pro decides to use more of the graphics instead of the CPU. Our main limitation in timeline performance is the CPU, whereas the other two programs, they function much better at full resolution 60 FPS because they're utilizing more of the graphics, not putting such a heavy workload on the actual CPU. Finally, let's take a look at 4.5K Red RAW. This is with two LUTs, it's graded, we have film grain applied, and in Final Cut, we get an export of 60% faster, in DaVinci Resolve almost 75% faster, and in Premiere Pro over 250% faster. That's 2.5 times as fast. Now, why are we getting much bigger percentages here than in the other RAW footage? Well, the Canon RAW is actually utilizing graphics more now than it did when it was launched. There's been improvements in software, whereas the Red RAW, it's pegging our CPU to the max, it's pegging our graphics to the max, especially in Premiere Pro. I mean, those are maxed out all the way. In the timeline, it's still not great with this iMac. If you wanna do like full resolution, you can do it at half res, it's a lot better, but there's a huge difference compared to the previous 2017 iMac. So now it's time to talk about who should be buying or upgrading to one of these new iMacs, who's it worth it for, who it isn't worth for, and also if you're gonna be upgrading or buying one, what configurations should you get? So starting out, if you edit with Premiere Pro and you can afford the upgrade, sell your previous one and pay the difference, I would say definitely pick one of these up. I mean, Premiere Pro loves to have the extra cores, the higher clock speed, especially for some of those titles and effects, and we see a big difference just across the board. Now, if you use Final Cut or DaVinci Resolve, and you're editing standard H.264 4K footage, maybe a little bit of multicam, a little bit of effects, honestly, I'm not seeing that big of a difference because both these programs, they've just gotten so much better over the years. Now, if you're somebody that's working with H.265 or RAW footage, especially RAW footage, I mean, absolutely. This thing with 8 cores, 16 threads, the thermal performance is good. It is a big, big step up, just like you guys saw. There's some massive improvements. Now, what about which configuration should you get? I gave you guys a sneak peek. If you're working with standard H.264 4K, the i5 580X is definitely a good option. But for most of you guys, if you're serious about video editing, I would say definitely step up to the i9. It's performing way better than I thought it would. And just to have those extra cores there, even if you don't need them right now, a year or 2 years from now, whenever you decide to upgrade your camera, it is really, really well worth it. But on the graphics side, this is where it gets a little bit more difficult. If you're editing with RAW footage, in that case, definitely go with Vega 48. You need the extra graphics horsepower. Now, on the other hand, with graphics, you can use external graphics card units, but it doesn't work well across the board. If you're editing with DaVinci Resolve, I would say in that case, if you don't absolutely need it, or if you don't have enough money, you're trying to budget a little bit, go for the 580X, the performance isn't that different. And then later you can pick up a Vega 64 graphics card with an external enclosure, plop it in, and DaVinci Resolve makes excellent use of external graphics cards. That's gonna give you even better performance than this. So for DaVinci users, think about using an external graphics card. Now, Final Cut can use external graphics cards, but it's not great yet. And for Final Cut users, I would say wait, don't get the external graphics card enclosure, get the internal graphics card, at least for now. In Premiere Pro, I think it's even worse for external graphics cards. In that case, if you edit with Premiere Pro, if you can afford the Vega 48 and the i9, do both. If you can't afford both, go with the i9. It's gonna give you a much bigger difference than jumping from the 580X to the Vega 48. So thank you guys for watching. Hopefully you guys enjoy this video. Once again, big shout out to Skillshare. Guys, seriously, go get 2 free months. It helps me out. They support the channel and that helps me out quite a bit. And it's also a great resource for you guys. There's a ton of great content on there as well. Of course, we have links to both the iMacs, the configurations I recommend, the RAM kit that I would recommend, and the little video on how to do it so you can save up to $680. Definitely check that out. You guys, of course, can subscribe if you guys want to see my comparison with this new i9 iMac compared to the $5,000 iMac Pro. This has been Max, and I will see you in the next video.